Are you ready to hear the word of God?
Amen.
Are you ready to hear the word of God?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And you turn with me to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, verse 11, please. One of you can read that verse. Romans 12, 11.
Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord.
What's the translation you read? That's the one I need. What's the translation?
What's the translation?
Yeah.
NIV.
NIV?
Yeah.
Yeah, can I put NIV there? No.
You don't have it.
Okay. Never lack the zeal. In other words, God wants us to be zealous for the Lord. Can you read Ephesians chapter 4 verse 18 also? Ephesians chapter 4 verse 18. Sorry, Galatians. Galatians chapter 4 verse 18. Galatians chapter 4 verse 18.
But it is good to be zealously affected always in a good thing, and not only when I am present with you.
Yeah, here Paul was writing to the church in Galatia, and he was saying, but it is good to be zealous, affected always in a good thing, and not only when I am present with you. In other words, always we must be zealous for God. Always we must have that zeal. Your fervent or zeal should not die or go down. Hallelujah. In other words, we are singing this morning, we are having the praise in our lips always. The same thing, the zeal must be there always. That's why Paul was saying when he wrote to Galatians, what we read in 4:18, he was saying, always you must don't have the zeal or zealous for God when I am with you, but always when I am not there also, you must have that zealous. You must have that zeal. In other words, that must be displayed in your life consistently. You must display the zeal for God consistently. Amen. Coming to church on Sunday morning, you can be fire for God or zeal for God. Then when you go to your workplace or school or university, you are not zealous for God, means your life something is wrong. You must have that zeal always. Amen?
Amen.
Turn to your neighbor and say, you must have that zeal for God every time, every minute, every moment of your life. So that zeal the zeal which we have for God, the zeal we have for God, it depends on the love we had for God. In other words, it depends on the greatest command God has given us. This again, you know this very well. Mark chapter 12, verses 30 and 31. Mark chapter 12, verses 30 and 31.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these.
Amen. So it's a zeal based on the greatest command which God has given to us. Love your God. What we read in Mark chapter 12, verse 30 and 31, it says, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength." This is the first commandment. The second is like, namely this: thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than this. So, loving God with all our strength and all our heart, as well as all our soul and all our mind. Loving God, one thing. The other one is love your neighbor. Love your neighbor. Love your neighbor. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh, Pastor, we know this. What is this you are saying? And you may think about that. But loving God with all your mind, all your strength, all your heart means doing everything for God. This morning, when I was preparing this message, actually this word, Romans chapter 12, verse 11, was given to me yesterday at the fasting and prayer. Specifically, God spoke to me to tell that word to one of the members. So from that only, I developed this message. When I was preparing this message, God said, two kinds of mindsets, two kinds of people will be seated here this morning. One kind of people is like this. Even though you are saying, even though the word says, the command says, love your God with all thy heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. Two kinds of people, or two mindsets are here. One mindset is, avoid responsibilities as much as possible. Even though you come to the service, you avoid responsibilities as much as possible. The reason behind that is, you have been hurt in the past. You have been hurt for something. And also, in other words, I can say this way, you are in a depressive state. Oh, this has happened in my life. I will never do anything for the Lord. You are in a depressive state. Amen? Because of stress, because of anxious. Why this has happened is you think that things happen in your life, these are unreasonable expectations. Unreasonable expectation in my life. So this is the mindset. If you have, God wants you to repent and come back, and God wants you to love Him with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. So avoid responsibility as much as possible in a depressive state because of stress and anxious. Also, you think unreasonable expectation. Because of that, you are far away from the Lord. You are unable to love the Lord with all your heart. You are unable to love the Lord with all your soul. You are unable to love the Lord with all your mind. Also, you are unable to love the Lord with all your mind. Second kind of people is, I come to church, I have some responsibility to fulfill. I will come and fulfill my responsibility. If I fulfill my responsibility, that's enough. In other words, coming to church has become like a responsibility. If I don't come, pastor will ask, or leader might ask, or my parents will ask because I will come. No, that's not a responsibility. God says, always, always we must praise Him. Always we must have that zeal. So, do to fulfill. The second mindset is, do to fulfill our responsibilities. Amen? But remember that. Every blessing, everything, whatever God has given in our life, even the tithe, even the talents, even our spiritual gifting, even the money or the possessions, whatever God has given, or the skills, whatever God has given, always God has given that to us, not to keep to ourselves, it to bless others. Mm-hmm. Amen? If I say it this way, our blessings, time, money, and skills need to be springbound to bless others. It must go back to others. That's the reason God gives those. Can you read Ephesians chapter 4, verse 28? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 28.
He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need.
Amen. This Paul was writing this scriptures, Ephesians, and he's saying, let him that steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, the things which is good, that he may have to give to him that needs. So work by your own hands, so that you will be able to, you can bless others. Luke chapter 14, verses 12 to 14. Luke chapter 14, verses 12 to 14.
Then Jesus said to his host, when you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back. They may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But When you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous.
It's very straightforward. So then said he also to him that bade him, when thou makest a dinner or a supper, call not thy friends, not thy brethren, neither any kinsman, nor thy rich neighbors. What you have to do is, you must call the poor, the lame, blind. Then in that way, you will be blessed. In other words, provide for the people who don't have. Provide for the needy people. That's the way God was saying that. Amen?
Amen?
So God gives us, God blesses us so that we can bless others. First Corinthians chapter 13 is a chapter of love. So I'm going to read verse 2. First Corinthians chapter 13 verse 2. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not love, I am nothing. In other words, whatever you do, you must always do in love. In other words, something we must avoid is truth without love. If you are helping someone, if you are helping a needy person, and if there is no love, if you are doing it for duty, that is useless. Always you must have love. Because of the agape love God has put inside you, that love must flow from you to the others. The unconditional love must flow from you to others. So, if this thing you must always avoid, truth without love. Word of God says in the book of Ephesians, speak the truth in love. We must speak the truth in love. So, truth without love is useless. Amen. It's true that we have to help others. God has blessed us. We must help the needy and so on. We have to love their neighbors as ourselves and so on. That is true. That is truth. But if you do it without love, really loving, that is useless. The same thing is applicable to Almighty God also. Loving Jesus or loving God. Love God with all of your heart, all of your mind, all of your soul, all of your strength. That must be the 100%. If you don't have that love, If you just come and worship and looking here and there, that is useless. God wants that 100% to Him. Amen? 100%. Always have that praise. Always have that worship in your lips. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So the question we have to ask is, personally we can ask, do I really bear with others' burden? Many people are with burden. We really bear with others' burden. Are we carrying others' burden? Are we looking to other people and saying, "Oh, these people, we must help." Even though we are able to help, if we don't help, that we have to be answerable to God. Amen? So that is very, very important. Also, another thing I want to tell you to avoid is, don't ever focus from the Bible one truth. Take one truth, and if you concentrate only in that truth, if you take one truth of the Bible and always you want to concentrate about that, definitely you are going to go away from the Word of God. Always you must have the balance. You must always have the balance. Don't ever focus on one truth and leave your life. That is a dangerous thing. You will be drawn away from the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So focusing on one truth, make sure there's a balance. That you must avoid. Something to avoid is focusing in one truth. Don't ever focus in one truth. Hallelujah. Can you read Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 18? Book of Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 18. Whoever fears God shall come forth of all of all. So if you have the fear of God, you will come forth from all of that. So how do we keep our zeal for God burning, of fire burning for God? How do you have that zeal without going down? How can you increase that zeal? How can you increase that zeal burning? The simple fact is the love of God. If without the love, the zeal will net, zeal will die away. If you want to have the zeal, you must have the love of God in your heart always. Amen. So Ephesians chapter 3, Ephesians chapter 3, verses 17 to 19. Very clearly Paul was saying the love, that Christ may dwell in your heart by faith, that he being rooted and grounded in love. You've been rooted and grounded in love. We know our faith is really rooted in God's love, Jesus' love. We are rooted and grounded in love. Also may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that he might be filled with all the fullness of God. So love of God, based on love of God only you can have that fire burning or the zeal burning. So I want to finish with three things to ponder, so you can write it down if you want. This will help your life to have the zeal in your life. First of all, remember this, Jesus' love or his love is not based on our performance or our perfection. His love is an unconditional love. It's an agape love. It's a sacrificial love. So remember this, always when you go through life, his love, Jesus' love is not based on our performance or perfection. So if you think that his love is based on our performance or perfection, that will lead us to think that God is a partial God. No, he is not a partial God. He sees everyone equally. Amen. So his love is not based on our performance or perfection. Secondly, we will not feel his love all the time. Many people fail there. Many people think that always we will feel his love. If you think that way, I am here to tell you, definitely you will come to a situation you won't feel your love, when you will go away from his from the faith. So that is, Satan can deceive you. So, secondly, we will not feel his love all the time. But when you don't feel his love at a particular moment of your life, what you should do? The secret is, think about the things God has done for you in your life. From your salvation, even the cross, how Jesus died on the cross, up to that particular moment, where you are not feeling his love, think about the things God has done in your life. When you think about the things God has done in your life, automatically you will start thanking the Lord. Then you will feel the love again. Amen. Why you don't feel love sometimes? The reason is, when we start focusing on the problems and the things of the world, what will happen is, automatically we will feel that his love is no more. So God doesn't want you to come to that situation. So we will not feel his love all the time. So at that time, think about what he has done for you. Think about the past. Think about the cross. Think about your salvation. Think about the good things God has done in your life. Thirdly, so we are loving the Lord with all our soul, all our mind, all our heart, and all our strength. Thirdly, also we know when we love him, he is also loving. That doesn't mean, being loved doesn't always mean we will get what we want. Being loved doesn't always mean we will get what we want. Sometimes we think if someone is loving us, whatever we ask that person must give it. No, it's not true. Always you will not get. Even though God is loving you, sometimes He will not give you because He has the total picture. We always think about the moment, but He has the total life, total of your life, or total picture of your life from beginning to the end. So He always gives what is good for you. So being loved doesn't always mean we will get what we want. So the three things with that I want to close. So remember these things. If you have not written it down, please write it down. It will help you in your day to come. Today you might be feeling, oh, I am zeal for the Lord, but tomorrow you might not have that zeal. That's the reason I am saying His love is not based on our performance or perfection. Secondly, we will not feel His love all the time. Thirdly, being loved doesn't always mean we will get what we want. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do you feel loved by God this morning? Or are you thinking that you are far away from the Lord? God wants you to have that intimate relationship. You, as we sung this morning, we must have the praise in our lips always. We must have the worship always. For that reason only, the Holy Spirit has given to us. Because of the Holy Spirit, we can have that intimate relationship always, anytime, any moment of our life. Amen? Holy Spirit will help us. Holy Spirit will help us. Now read Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. Romans chapter 8, verse 28.
Know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose.
Amen. All things work for good. If you have called, you remember that. And we know that all things work together for good. To those who love God, if you are loving God, remember everything. Whatever happens in life, whatever happening in your life, is for your own good. To those who are called according to His purpose. If you have been called according to purpose, and if you know that God is loving you, remember that. Whatever happened, whatever is happening in your life, it's for your own good. Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Now I can ask questions. I want you to repeat what I said, the 3 points. Who can tell without looking at your notes? If you can't carry your notes wherever you go, you must have it in your mind. If you're going to carry your notes wherever you want to go, you must be carrying like encyclopedias, the books and books. Hallelujah. So you must have it here. Some people think, oh, they don't need to write. It's simple. We can have it. But the moment the service is over, you will forget that. That's the reason I want you to write. I don't know whether you can remember when we were there earlier in Pharmacy Church. I always insist, have a notebook and write. Amen? I think I had to bring that back. Hallelujah. Don't ever listen by one ear and leave it. It will go by the other ear. Hallelujah. Always write it down. That will help you. Amen? I can tell you, I have notes from the day of my salvation. Wherever I go, I'll write. Always write. That I learned. The day I got saved, the person who discipled me taught me to do that. That will help us. That will help. When suddenly I will remember, oh, these things I heard somewhere, I will search where it is and I'll find it. That's the way God is. Amen? Write it. That will help you. So the 3 things, His love is not based on our performance or perfection. We will not feel His love all the time. Being loved doesn't always mean we will get what we want. Shall we stand to our feet? Oh, by the way, Krishant, Pastor David Satya Siva's son, he was here last week also. No one welcomed.